It's not a big group, so should be all right. The talk I'm going to give today is titled "What I Talk About When I Talk About Platforms," because it's such an indefinite and kind of abstract word that can mean a lot of different things. So that's with apologies to Haruki Murakami, who wrote a book called "What I Talk About When I Talk About Running." Running is why I've hurt my ankle, and so that's no good.
Evan, may I interrupt just briefly to say that is the most ThoughtWorks slide I've ever seen in my life.
It doesn't actually have the ThoughtWorks logo on it.
It doesn't need to.
Yeah, I picked the, you might find some of the others do. I work for ThoughtWorks. I'm a principal consultant. I mostly work around, I'm a developer by craft. I don't really get to write as much code as I'd like to. I work mostly as a technical advisor in architecture and work with CTOs and CIOs and strategy groups and things around structure of organizations and technology underpinnings and all that sort of good stuff. But I still really like being close to delivery and hands-on as much as I can be. I've been with ThoughtWorks for 11 and a half years. And ThoughtWorks has grown in that time from being about 600 people globally to almost 5,000 now. So I've seen quite a big change in the way the organisation works. And for the last few years, I've also had the great kind of privilege of being part of the ThoughtWorks Global Technology Advisory Board, working with our CTO, and producing a publication in May of kind of had a look at, which is the ThoughtWorks Technology Radar, kind of is like emerging trends and hype cycle stuff for technology and techniques and things like that. So I always like to drop this picture in. I always try to explain to my mum what I do, and she just doesn't get it at all. And then I show her a picture of my face on the billboard at Times Square, and she gets that. So that was a blip highlight in my career. I think it was up there for about 18 seconds. With more technology folk, I get more kudos for this picture, which is me with my colleagues Martin Fowler and James Lewis, who did the sort of foundational work around describing microservices and the patterns there. I look a little bit different now, mostly because of running. I realised that to be a technology leader, you have to wear a cap and drink a pint of beer. So, but back to platforms, that wasn't very interesting. So what's a platform? This is the dictionary definition. It's always good to start with one of those. It's a major piece of software under which various smaller programs can run. That's a software platform. And we come to realize we talk about platforms a lot. And kind of the way, I'm not very good at articulating this, but it's really, a lot of it comes down to centralizing and making the most of scarce expertise in order to enable innovation. You think about an operating system as a platform. There's not very many kernel engineers, and so they spend all their time thinking about building that extremely high performing, scalable, might be a disk IO subsystem of the operating system, and then applications can be built on top of that that make use of that platform. So that's kind of what a platform is. And at organizational scale, we're talking about ways to deal with scarce specialties and scarce capabilities and placing them organizationally so that they can enable innovation and for us to meet that customer demand faster and more effectively. So it's kind of platforms. But something's picking up a little static behind me. Anyway, I'll ignore that. So to talk, I want to tell this through some stories. And being a software developer and having spent a lot of time around ops and engineering, I'm going to dive into infrastructure and hosting, which is kind of quite often what we talk about in terms of platforms, internal platform structures in organizations. And I tell a little story about a financial services organization I went to visit, called in to spend some time working out where the constraints are in our delivery process. It takes us months to deliver any piece of work. It takes a long time, a lot of heartache, and everyone's unhappy and what's actually going on. And I thought, well, I'm going to tackle the part around operations and infrastructure and hosting. And I'll go and investigate, have lots of conversations. I want to take a piece of work, I want to follow a change that we want to make. I want to follow it through the process and see what's involved. And I discovered at this large financial services organisation that there are a number of siloed parts of that ops and hosting kind of area. And so, there was networks and firewalls and security and database and middleware teams that took care of the application servers and mid-range who took care of the operating system and the configuration of the operating system. And they all sat completely separately and they all had their own ways of working and they all passed work between each other through ticketing systems. That was only the start of it. There was also, I already mentioned network, security, the firewalls, which was outsourced to one telco, and then the wider area network stuff, which was outsourced to a different telco. Then there's enterprise change, enterprise release, enterprise monitoring, storage, which was outsourced to another vendor. And so you get this idea of a bunch of little towers, each of which you have to interact with in order to get a change through. And we're talking, minor changes in months time frame. The smallest piece of work that you could do in this organization was around the 3 to 5 month time frame. So we talked about what is the real big problem with this, trying to describe what's going on here. And you can see this pattern of backlog coupling, is what I've kind of started to call it. It's probably better ways of describing it. But I want to do some work to service the customer's needs. It might be introducing a new feature in my, let's say it's insurance system that requires some change in another system. So I have a requirement, I have a piece of work in my backlog, and then for that piece of work, in fact most pieces of work, I then have to go and ask someone else to raise a ticket in their backlog. And then they receive that, they go, right, I've looked at that, now I need to go and ask someone else to do some piece of work. You have all these queues in the organisation that all have to be, all have to complete work in order to complete something back to some sort of actual meaningful business outcome. That's pretty obvious, but we've spent a lot of time kind of in our industry trying to make that process run more smoothly and assistance and prioritisation, but ultimately it comes down to who speaks loudest, who has the highest power to pick up their work and push it to the front of the queue. And the overall time, average time through, is weeks and months. We did a study, colleagues of mine at Telco collected a whole bunch of data about work that was being done in their delivery team, delivery teams, big program of work. And they determined, by measurement, that a piece of work that could be completed by one team took one unit of time. If that work relied on a dependency, a piece of work to be done by another team, on average it was 10 to 12 times longer elapsed time, even though the actual effort involved was the same. So I would have thought that'd be 3 to 4 times. That would be a reasonable guess, but they measured it as 10 to 12 times in that organisation. So we're talking significant delay and inefficiency. And not necessarily everyone's machines are operating at whatever capacity they're running at, but the overall elapsed time to deliver a useful feature is slowed down by these kind of factors. So we worked with that organisation, the financial services organisation, and talked about creating, improving the capability around hosting and provisioning infrastructure, making it accessible to teams that needed to deliver software change without having to raise as many tickets, and talked about the concepts of self-service. And so their first effort around that essentially put their existing siloed structure inside a box and put an API on the front. And it's an audacious goal, but they had an API that could spin up a fixed piece of infrastructure, did not provide any access to that infrastructure to do anything meaningful. It wasn't connected to a network. It had no load balancers or any of the other kind of kit around it that you needed to do anything meaningful with the infrastructure that was available when you use the API. And then you, so you had one small bit that was self-service, and you then needed to raise tickets and go back into the queuing system and jockey for position and fight to get a piece of work out in anything less than months. So that's also not a platform. It's something you can, it's maybe the very, very kernel of a platform, but there's such a long roadmap ahead of that that part of the organization. We talked about this in the ThoughtWorks technology radar as the superficial private cloud offering. You basically take your existing virtualization and you make the API available. You've probably even got a very pretty interface. A lot of people focus on the clicking. Now, the clicking is the important part. It's actually the repeatability of scriptable interfaces, but that's beside the point. When I introduced that to the group, I actually called it the half-assed private cloud, but that didn't quite get to publication. What we saw in that organization was we unlocked the ability for teams to access AWS, Amazon Web Services, directly. Got those Amazon Web Services accounts connected to the networks and through security, and then we watched essentially an unleashed torrent of innovation and rapid deployment on AWS, because AWS is a platform. Is a good platform in those senses. So, AWS is a platform. You never raise a ticket, or you very, very rarely raise a ticket with Amazon Web Services professional support people to do anything for you. You either make use of the capabilities of that platform through its APIs, or you don't, and you work around the capabilities of that platform. And everything is self-service, and everything, you're responsible for everything that you run on the platform. Amazon is responsible for providing an available hosting, compute and storage and network and all the different capabilities, hundreds and hundreds of capabilities that Amazon provide, and you're responsible for what you deploy on. So the key things, or key conclusion here, a platform, an effective platform, really has to have some attributes. It has to be self-service. It has to be genuinely enabled for teams who are trying to do delivery to access it without having to raise tickets. It has to, some specifics around deployment and infrastructure is that you have to provision, team has to provision the kit, they have to be responsible for the kit, and they have to have access, the right level of access to configure that kit without having to go and raise tickets, which really means a platform that's no tickets. I say, I put the little wildcard, a little Asta. Doesn't really look like an Asta. Obviously not absolutely everything. I've worked with organizations that have heavy use of AWS, but still occasionally need to interact with some central group, maybe on like a once a quarter basis for something that's not in your path of delivery. But it means almost no ticketing. By the way, if anyone wants to interrupt me and ask, kind of stop me, ask questions, clarify, please do. So AWS is a platform. I can categorically say it is a platform. The half-assed private cloud is not a platform. Good. So what does that mean? Should we just send everybody off to use Amazon? Everyone should just use an outsourced private public cloud unleash the world to use that and just take away all kind of internal capability around that stuff. I don't know. So I worked for 3 years stationed at REA, realestate.com.au. I don't talk about many clients, but these guys are so public about what they've achieved with public cloud and what their path to that journey and some of the stuff that they've dealt with that it's okay to talk about that. We went on that journey. I was involved a little bit in that migration to public cloud, and the concept that came through for REA very importantly was team managed infrastructure. So they actually divided their even down to Amazon account structure, so that individual delivery teams would have their own Amazon kind of account, which is pretty much everything, and define everything from the ground up. So turn the dial completely towards teams managing their own infrastructure. from the ground up, from some templates and some shared kind of ideas, but ultimately they're completely responsible from the ground up. At REA, and also at other organisations that I've observed doing this, there's a challenge around that. The cloud native or cloud ecosystem, just modern software engineering and deployment and infrastructure, is really quite complex. It's a lot of options, a lot of choices that you have to make, and lessons that you have to learn along the way. Who's familiar with this? Anybody seen this before? So this one's a little bit out of date. This is the cloud native landscape. It's basically just an assessment. It's not meant to be exhaustive. For each of the kind of areas of the stack for building cloud native applications, what are some of the choices that you've got? And you know, so everything from infrastructure as a service, provisioning runtime, what sort of orchestration management, what monitoring tools you're going to use, what sort of service discovery tools. There's a bunch of different choices. And these are just all things that you could potentially run, that aren't necessarily that you're going to use them all from Amazon. Make a choice between them all. And they all have strengths and weaknesses. And if you have 20 teams in your organization, they're going to have to make some choices about what they want to do. And they won't get them right, and there'll be a bit of rework, and there'll be lessons learned horizontally between the teams, but ultimately they're going to have to become proficient in this whole landscape. This one's out of date. This is the latest one I downloaded today. It's gotten even bigger. And I would say, that's only a few months, I would say that there's a few things that are missing here too that are pretty glaringly obvious. The first one that jumped out at you was there's nothing around tools for doing pager notifications and problem and incident management tools, ticketing, there's a lot of options in that space as well. And you're going to have to make those choices if you're doing your own managed infrastructure at a team level. So organizations, let's introduce this device. I've seen organizations that either have a bias, and generally in the industry we have bias towards centralized solutions, centralized governance and control for economies of scale. And a lot of organizations are throwing that completely the other way towards complete autonomy for teams at a team level. Now you're responsible for these systems and this capability, and you have your own choices to make. You also have to live with what you build. And it's great because at this end, you get great innovation and you get great responsibility. I made this choice. I'm also responsible for paying for it, for maintaining it ongoing, all those sort of things. Centralization, you get great sharing, economies of scale, but you also get a lot of boat anchor solutions that are not fit for purpose for every environment. So there's a tension here. And I think there's no right answer, and it also depends a lot on your organization, but I see there's a bit of a path that a number of organizations I talk to, where they move towards the complete autonomy stage until it hurts, and then they turn it back a notch or two. And so organizations are doing that. A number of organizations, including REA, they're probably going to publish some stuff about this in the near future, are doing is looking at what are the best things that we've learned through going through this kind of growth period, a big flowering of new ideas and variation. Which of them can we pull down to create a platform, a platform offering that you can use, that our teams can use to get there faster and to reduce the amount that they have to invest to either start up a new team, new capability, or even just take out some cost of carrying cost for our existing teams. And so delivery platform, which is where I'm talking about right now, some of the sort of things that I'm seeing there. Version control systems, that's kind of an obvious choice. It's not really that much distinction between version control systems. It's probably something you can have one of for a fairly large organization. Continuous delivery pipelines is becoming less. Platforms as a service, monitoring, log aggregation, everything that's on that kind of cloud native thing. You might be able to choose some options there and bring together a team or form a capability that may not be aligned to a team, but have this kind of shared capability around a platform. Slippery slope. You quickly, you know, I can imagine we quickly go back to our default behavior of centralized governance and control, and end up with crappy solutions that aren't actually fit for purpose. I had this conversation with a different financial services institution, with essentially a CTO, and he said, "But you know, a continuous integration server, that surely is something that we want to centralize. Like, you know, you want to run that centrally. How could it possibly, you know, cause friction for teams wanting to use it?" And then I, you know, really had to paint, like, to take him to the work and get him to see that the delivery teams are constantly blocked on access control, creating new projects. The existing tools, the existing platform software applications for continuous delivery servers don't have very good support for handing out control to teams, the right level of control, so that they can do the sort of things that they need to, self-service. They tend towards this governed, centralized model. And so you have to actually start with the idea that it's not a compelling centralized offering until it's proven that it is. But sort of some of the things that we talk about in creating these platform teams, even just for delivery infrastructure, is they need to think of themselves as a competitive product. You need to say, I'm an offering in this organization. I'm offering you the ability to set up, to host application containers or something like that. And I'm API driven, and here is the on-ramp, and I've got some documentation and some training, and here's the cost model. And if you use my product, then you will get these benefits. But you're not forced to. You could just go straight to Amazon. And all of a sudden, I'm in a competitive market. I really need to be thinking about it as a product and applying product management techniques. You know, thinking about the value proposition, thinking about the product canvas, thinking of even about the metrics. You know, can I measure net promoter score? You know, think about pirate metrics. You know, how many people are using it? What's their retention? What's their drop off? Some of the compelling features for these products is that they need to support innovation and don't apply constraints to the way you want to work with them. They need to be composable, so you can use one of the services but not have to buy the whole stack, because one of the things you provide might be a really good fit for a team, but not the whole thing. So composability is really important. Some of the things you like Amazon, it's very quick and easy to get started. You really just kind of click, put your credit card in. You might even get, like, you know, a free budget like you do currently with the Google Cloud platform. So even internally, your internal platforms need to be easy for developers and technical people in your organization to get started with. Other things that are compelling: secure and compliant by default, you know, auditable, all these things that sort of basically make the job for application development teams easier. But you still, I think, you have to compete. You have to recognize, or a lot of shared services providers, which is, you know, the alternate, they're kind of like the only show in town. They have a monopoly. You can only use my vSphere cluster because it's our enterprise standard. And if you don't use it, then I'll tell the CIO and you'll get spanked. Well, no, we actually want to set up a bit of competition internally. And the product offering from an internal platform is a bit more than just like APIs, right? It's also got to come with consulting and training and how-to guides and sample code and all these things that make it easier to get on board and start to use the capabilities of the platform. One of my clients, they were building internal capability, again, around deployment, and they said that they were seeing a very, very poor uptake internally until they went out and did a series of training courses. Basically went to different teams and said, we'll teach you how to use it, and we'll sit in your team for a while and get you deployed with one service, and we'll essentially show you how easy it is, like the kind of problems that this tooling that they were providing will solve. And then they saw a rapid uptake, and it's actually become essentially the default, a sensible default for that organization is to use their deployment tooling.
Cool.
So one of the common breakouts that people have, if you're familiar with the DevOps movement, is that if you create a team around this internal delivery infrastructure platform, is that you're creating a DevOps team. And in the ThoughtWorks technology radar, that we've had that in our hold quadrant, like the do not do this thing since July 2014. I had to go and look that up. I don't think it has to, although it might, because, you know, I talk like this to people and they hear what they want to hear and they think, yes, DevOps is a service. No, that's actually not what DevOps is at all. But you're creating a team, and the negative outcome, the path that would take you away, would be that this is just a relabel of your existing hosting team, and people give them an application package and they go and deploy it and they monitor it and they get woken up and then they tell the application team that there's a bug. That's not what we're talking about. I like this. I think I picked this up, these things. I have no original thought. I'm just a repeat of everything I've ever heard. Google has had Borg. Has anyone heard of Borg? I think it's got a different name now. I can't think what it is, but Borg is their highly scalable compute infrastructure, like incredibly scalable, Google-scale compute infrastructure. And over time, it's become pretty much the default that if you have to run anything at Google, it runs on Borg. And it's a set of tools and infrastructure that allow you to package up some unit of computing, container-like thing, and deploy it onto Borg, and it will run. And it will run across multiple regions and be highly scalable and fail over cleanly and do all these really good things for you that you don't have to worry about, because they've got a whole bunch of really smart people who deal with making the platform work as an app. But they don't care what you run. In fact, they don't even know what you are running on Borg. So they've got, instead of thinking about DevOps, they've actually got a little bit more nuance. There are people who run the platform, and they're good at highly scalable infrastructure and container subsystems and storage and networking, and right down to people who rack and stack blades in servers to run the thing. That's all platform ops. I don't know too much detail around it. But they're not responsible for what you run. They don't even care if it falls over. They only care about what they provide as a platform. And then you have application ops who sit essentially running those applications. And I think that's an important nuance. You have to have that separation of responsibility. So, zoom out a bit. At a large insurance company, not so long ago, we were working on this platform problem, and it wasn't just a delivery infrastructure problem kind of point of view. It's actually a whole of organization. And this is actually a very common conversation now. A lot of big organizations are looking at models that are a little bit like this. Now, I'm very simplified, sorry about my scrolls. I actually drew these cards in the back of a global meeting and I was kind of bored, drew out the presentation on the desk, took photos of them, put it together for a lightning talk that night, and I've become kind of attached to it, so I haven't gone and drawn them formally. Nobody's offended. But on the left, I'll build on this, is Teams, the part of your organization that has a direct interaction with a customer. You might be a line of business. I'll use insurance as an example because it's a domain I'm kind of familiar with. You might be personal insurance automotive, and you're a line, and you have a particular brand in market, you have a particular customer value proposition. You differentiate by the experience your customer has with dealing with you. So you probably have teams that are around creating that digital experience, mobile channel, web channel. Probably not much emphasis on B2B, but so you've got that kind of teams over there. And those teams, I think of as being the business. They have access to the data around their customer need, they devise a problem statement, a hypothesis, they test it in market, you build something quickly, you put it out into the market. And you want that turnaround to be really, really fast so you're responsive to customer need. And And that's what I picture as being that classic agile team, you know, two pizza teams sitting at a desk, moving quickly, deploying quickly in the market. Not many insurance companies would get quite there, but they're getting there slow. But they always get really, really slow when they have to deal with the systems of record, so the back end, you know, policy management system, pricing, figuring rules and things like that. So what if we thought about those things as business platforms that are actually API driven? So thinking about our rules from before, what if those core business capabilities, like, you know, defining a product, pricing a product, taking a risk assessment, like actually creating an insurance policy right through to claims, the whole lifecycle, if those business capabilities were available to your product teams as self-service, so that the product teams themselves can configure the new product attributes without having to go and raise a ticket in the core insurance system team. If you reduce that backlog, if you actually had those things available as a compelling platform. So thinking about that business platform layer is really where kind of our thinking is now. I think it's a really, really sticky, awkward problem. None of the existing landscape of any organization looks like that. And none of the big package vendors that are selling insurance, core insurance systems or core banking systems or any of those things are designed to support this. They are designed for that backlog coupling where you have a team of specialists who just do the configuration and they're doing it for every line of business you've got. So it's a really interesting big challenge. It's a really big hairy challenge. And sitting behind that is the technology platforms, the sort of enabling platforms we're talking about before, being able to host things, being able to send emails and being able to store things and having data lakes and data marts accessible. They're the technology platforms. But I think the really, really interesting big challenge, the one that's going to really, companies that can get this right, I think it could be a real enabler, is the business platforms. I drew this picture on the way up. I'm going to try, just before I conclude, you can tell me I'm batshit crazy. I apologise for my two-year-old scrawling. I said to my colleague today, look, I just wish I could draw. I can't, you know, it looks like it's been drawn by a two-year-old. He said, no, two-year-olds don't understand perspective of it. fair enough. This is you're the first to see this. I'm just trying to explain what I mean a little bit clearer. What we see here is those digital teams, or what I think of that as actually the business. They're the people who push product out to customers. This is where you really want to optimize for fast turnaround to your customers. Behind that in yellow are generally the platforms that support your particular business, right? So in insurance, they would be core policy, claims, supply chain, some of those core capabilities that are very specific to the insurance industry. And then behind that in brown, sorry, Mr. Brown, are the things that the business capabilities that are kind of generic to every organization, HR, document management, workflow, not workflow, it's a different thing, but imaging, kind of some of that stuff. And then underlying that is the technology platforms. And what we've done in the past with project delivery, these are all just munged together as a really big complex coupled landscape with no seams in it, right? So a project would deliver across a big slice of this, right? We're delivering a new project, so we have to line up resources in every part of this kind of architecture. People who touch all that, put them in a project, whip them until they deliver something, and then they smash it into the systems landscape. What we want to do is to pull that apart a little bit, create seams between these, so you have less dependencies, and you can deliver more work directly to a customer, and each of these would have its own independent roadmap. I don't know if it helps, but I like the picture. So what would we measure? And the one thing that we started to measure in some, like, how would you know if your architecture is heading in the right direction and your org structure and your strategy is kind of is going to deliver on this? One of the leading measures for this would be actually measuring this backlog complete. Like, if you've got a product team, how many of their backlog items can they actually complete without, you know, having to go outside? And what's the average wait time for everything they, where they go outside that team? If we know that's going to be high right now because it's the truth in all of our organisations. But if you start to make the right kind of changes and start the investment in platform building, you should see that reduce your ratio of work that can be completed versus work that you need dependency for. There really should be a conclusion slide here that I don't have. Questions?
Yeah, I found your notion of business platform really interesting. So I came across exactly this problem, and I still haven't solved it. So the context is a bit different to what, so it's not insurance, but MDM, master data in CPG. So in a nutshell, master data in CPG, product, pricing, customer. Now, that specific design choice was to bolt all of this into an existing ERP, so it's a big, you know, piece of block, and give that to someone that would operate that system on your behalf. So now you would start seeing that, you know, okay, if we need a change for the product space, actually I'm not talking to people that manage or have domain expertise in product, but actually I'm talking to the guy that owns the IT system. Mm-hmm. So I put a ticket into their backlog. And so I basically create an industry around maintaining requirements in that specific system, where the people that maintain that requirement have nothing to do with the actual domain. So how do you overcome this challenge? You know, so it's a big block. It's a system that's been there for 10 years, right? There's some organizational constraints. I like the idea, it's hard to achieve.
It's very hard to achieve. I think it's very hard to achieve without a big, courageous, like, audacious kind of goal set by a leader who says, we've got to change your organization. Mm. Because the organizational change has to happen first, I think.
And what's happening is now, you know, okay, people have given up, and they're now going down the RPA route. Right? So they're trying to find automation, robotic process automation is a better term for UI scripting.
Okay.
And then basically take all of that chunk of manual work that's required to configure a requirement into the ERP and just automate that part. And you know what can happen with UI scripts is they tend to break. So you basically solve one problem by creating another one, and then you solve that problem by creating another one. And so it's this chain of issues which slows down the ability to experiment, the ability to create services around, for example, product maintenance. So CPGs churn out a huge number of SKUs per year, right? They launch a campaign, they need an SKU, they need to define what the attributes are, get that out as fast as they can, but it takes 6 months, right, for these reasons.
Yep. No magic. I have no magic answer.
I wish you had.
In a, we have lots of methods for getting off legacy systems that are sometimes interesting. Hmm. We, another organization, had a really badly mangled, over-customized CRM system in their core that did not only a little bit of CRM, but also contract management, product definition, pricing, did I say contract management? I did, yeah. As well as kind of a big overlap into billing and all this sort of thing. So we had this growth in the number of lines of business, each wanting to diversify their products. They want to, you know, interesting and unusual pricing methodologies. And this team trying to maintain this legacy system that was doing pricing is just getting slammed. And the complexity in that is just going through the roof because it's having to deal with essentially a growth in the product diversity. So, you know, we had to do some fine cuts into that legacy to allow us to move the essentially the pricing and half of the billing functionality out into the lines of business and be replicated.
Hmm.
And say, you guys are responsible for your weird-ass pricing rules and billing rules. You just, you know, at the end, the central billing capability just collects up the amount to put on the invoice from each of the lines of business. So basically just moving that responsibility out while still keeping a lot of the legacy stuff behind.
Hmm.
So, you know, it's carefully picking apart that kind of legacy system that's probably got about 16 different functions and taking one of them and saying, it's okay for it to be replicated and moved out.
Hmm. That is kind of a convenient example where you have an isolated piece of functionality that conveniently has a one-to-one mapping to the data to your like sort of core system.
Mm-hmm.
Usually it's not like that. You want to create the functionality that between your application stack and your infrastructure stack, there's usually a spider's web of your data layer. And when you want to sort of build some new functionality, you do have to tie into all that stuff, and you do end up bogged down in trying to re-architect your business data model just to deliver a single piece of functionality. It doesn't always pair off nicely like that.
And I probably did the hand wavy, that, you know, that sounded like it was easier than it really was, because that pricing and contract data went absolutely everywhere across the place. So yeah, a big mapping exercise, a big piece, you know, a big ball of wool to untangle. But, yeah, agreed, it's hard.
So when you talk about doing the business services and kind of breaking them down to make them self-service, do you have any ideas of how you go deeper in that? So like, for instance, if you were defining like the banking service, the banking platform, what are the kinds of APIs you're thinking you put there that make that kind of that self-service beautiful?
In banking, I'm not sure.
Okay, in insurance.
Yeah.
Then.
In insurance, it was very challenging. I've only seen the early stages of being able to define product variants outside of the core system. So essentially, you know, you're through, and it wasn't even wasn't an API driven thing. It was define files and source control that were, this is the part that belongs to this line of business, as opposed to the core things. So the core team would define, here are all the different questions you can ask, here are all the different kind of rating factors that you need to gather for this type of product. This is all the possible attributes for a motorcycle policy to make that up. And then the line of business would say, okay, we want this subset and this ordering.
But even there, if they suddenly decide to get into boats, you can't, like, you're not necessarily going to be able to find an API to get anything coming down into that. But you'd have to go even more generic again if they just add some entire new thing to ensure.
Yeah, you would need to then take the next step of being able to define it from scratch.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's one, I don't think everything, so not everything has to be completely API driven and configurable from the other team. There are different, there are some types of change for which maybe you've got a core system that does need a change now and then, for which your platform team, business platform team, might actually go and station some people as consultants sitting in the line of business. So that those occasional changes, you know, that they have a fixed capacity to do those. But different, that's still different to queuing up at the door asking, can you do this for me? We've done that a bit too.
The pattern that I found working in that context was that product variants would be handled outside of the system. So basically, you know, don't touch the ERP. You handle variants outside the system, and then you employ people to maintain these variants back into the copy of the data model inside the ERP. So the variants and changes in business rules were in fact handled as Excel macros outside the system. And this is a global corporation that is, you know, they run their entire, everything from a campaign for a shampoo to whatever it may be, bundling of products is basically first meant, it begins its life in an Excel spreadsheet. Right? So that's the API. And then the decoupling happens through manual typing in of that requirement back into the system. And the simple reason is that these systems are 10, 15 years old, if not longer. And they were never designed, so there's classic three-tier architectures, and they were designed around, you know, domains that you can break up and package up and expose individually. And that's a huge issue. Because you basically, and core banking is even worse. I mean, the life cycle for core banking is in excess of 20 to 30 years. AAD, I think, runs 10, so it's 30 years. And it takes 10 years to deliver the project.
You know, it's achieved right now. I think at the end of the day, you're not going to have one silver bullet for these things, right? So in different organizations, the legacy aspect of the system and the type of service you're looking for might mean you have a mix and match of things to try and make it as self-service as possible.
I think every organization is going to have a mix of these things. That's why I say that measurement slide. There's a concept that we've been talking about a bit called evolutionary architecture. And the intent there is that you should have some measurable fitness function. So each change you make to your overall architecture, and I think architecture and organizations, we know that they work together, and like organizational structure and responsibilities, they all work hand in hand. So what the fitness function would say, are you heading in the right direction? You know, is this mutation of your architecture a win or a loss? And so I think that the backlog coupling as a measure is an interesting one to drive change, but you know that it's going to be very, very high right now. You can't get anything done because these systems don't have it, and you're going to, you're either going to be working around them using Excel macros. I hope, I'm hoping that we can drive more discipline by explicitly calling out the model and saying there's a strong engineering discipline even in the product teams. But you're only going to be ratcheting it down slowly over time. Yeah, probably by starting with the ones that change the most.
It's huge. And even with technologies that have been tried, tested, and have been out there for quite some time, recently talking to a large company in the mining sector, basically takes 6 months to deliver a single API change. So these are ERP side APIs that have been around for 20, 30 years. That can be exposed. It's an RFC, and you can expose them via an ESB, basically. It's a common pattern that you can find. But just to take a single change from the API gateway, which was the architecture, into the ESB, into the ERP, was a six-month project.
Mm.
It's one API call in back, 6 months.
So ESBs, we've had ESBs in hold since like 2010, right? ESBs and the team structure around the ESB is one of the strongest form of backlog coupling we ever see.
Yeah.
You want to make expose one function from a core system, and now I've got to arrange resources, people, I mean, not resources, from my core system, my ESB and integration team, probably a security team, plus my API gateway team.
Exactly.
And everybody's got to kind of line that work up to be the top. So, it's often you can make changes in the core systems much, much quicker than you can coordinate the ESB team to do the canonical modeling of the data structure and expose the service. But it's one of the worst scourges in terms of that stuff. But that's a whole another talk.
And I might call it there, and we can try and grab Evan afterwards or offline. So please join me in thanking Evan for coming and talking to us tonight. So most months we do a local announcements and other things that are coming up that you'd like to share with the community. Does anyone have some upcoming events that they'd like to let people know about?
Obviously there's Yao, 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 and Yao.
Yes, we have a whole bunch of Yao coming up. There's Yao Data in about a month's time. There's Yao CTO Summit, which has its call for papers open at the moment. CTO Summit is probably the closest thing to a national conference that matches what we do at this meetup. So if you're interested in everything we do, you're probably interested in looking at that conference. And they're running that the end of November, start of December in Sydney and Melbourne, unfortunately not Brisbane. And following that, there's Yao proper that has all the usual Yao tech streams attached to it. Which is very well worth looking into and sending your teams along to. It's an extraordinarily valuable venture to invest into. Any others?
There's
Yao Connected.
There's Chris Biggs and I speaking
up. Chris Biggs and Lorraine, who are two regulars at CTO school.
I think, are you speaking there?
Yeah.
Yeah, Anna's speaking there too, yeah.
All the more.
Everybody come heckle us.
And speaking of Anna, it's not too late to get tickets for this Friday. She's running a UX testing seminar, which is how you can tell that what your engineering team is working on is going to have an impact on for your marketing team, your sales team, and representing it to them in a good way, which is always valuable to have for proving your worth to the company. Any others? No? Okay, well, the same appeal I make every month. If you want to come up and talk about something, please let us know. Or if you have someone you respect and that you think has something valuable to say, introduce them to us and we'll bother them until they come and talk to us. We hope to see you all back for October's CTO school. Look forward to an announcement in about 2 weeks. Hopefully I'll have the video up for this one in about a week and a half. Thank you all for coming. If you wouldn't mind, please stacking stools at the placard end of the room. And we'll migrate from here to the pub probably. Thank you all for coming.